Greetings from Bharat Institute of Law. Myself, Archana K., Assistant Professor, Bharat Institute of Law, Bharat Institute of Higher Education and Research. In this session, we'll be dealing with the interrelationship between human rights and environment. This topic is covered under the subject environmental law. In this session, we'll be dealing with the international instruments and national laws that upholds the human rights and right of every human being to a clean and healthy environment. Let's move into the session. Environmental protection and human rights are two of the main concerns of modern international law. After the establishment of the United Nations, the main focus of the international community was the protection and promotion of human rights. It was only in 1972 when the voice about environmental protection arose at the domestic level, became the global political agenda. The movement actually started from the Stockholm Conference and is still continuing by international conferences. The governments all over the world started recognizing the ecological interdependence of the world and acknowledged an urgent need to take action for the protection of the environment. The Stockholm Declaration of 1972, Nairobi Declaration of 1982, World Charter for Nature 1980, Earth Summit of 1992, Johannesburg Conference on Sustainable Development 2002, United Nations Conference on Sustainable Development 2012, etc. are some of the outcomes of the worrying state of world community. The central point of all these conferences is that ignoring the environment in the short run may leave long-term bad effects on the humanity and subsequently the violation of human rights. Though the issue of environment protection came later to human rights on the global agenda, but these two areas are definitely interrelated, interconnected, and mutually responsive. Both are concerned with the development and promotion of human well-being. To live in a healthy and quality environment is the fundamental or basic human right. While human rights are necessary to the overall development of human personality, material comfort, and the quality environment is equally necessary to safeguard the conditions conducive to such a personality development. Human rights and environmental protection are linked because both are required in order to achieve the highest quality of life for all. The right to health, the right to safe and healthy working condition, the right to adequate housing, food, these all are fundamental human rights recognized in international human rights instruments. The present scenario of unsustainable development is meant to large superstructure, mega dams, and large industrial units by multinational companies, mining and tourism activities, which have the potential to oust millions of people in one stroke without taking into account their economic, social, and cultural aspects of life. The dam projects, mining activities, rapid industrialization, etc. have affected the people in large number. So this is the very reason that the voice of resistance came up at all those places where such projects are either proposed and have already been established. So such unsustainable development leads to the violation of fundamental human rights that is the right to life due to contaminated air and water, noise pollution, and the loss of biodiversity. So exposure to toxic chemicals through careless hazardous waste disposal or industrial practices and utilization of pesticides for agricultural purposes are also the reason of environmental degradation and causes the violation of fundamental human rights. The traditional international environmental law that addresses the rights and obligations between states in reference to the environmental issues has little to do with offering individuals harmed due to environmental damage. People whose health or livelihood is threatened by exposure to hazardous waste or the pollution of streams and rivers, depletion of groundwater level, etc., have no recourse under international environmental laws. Moreover, people harmed by the environmental degradation are often the minority people, indigenous people who are marginalized within their own states. So linking human rights with the environment creates a rights-based approach to environment protection that places the people harmed by environmental degradation at its center. So articulating the fundamental rights of people with respect to the environment creates the opportunity to secure those rights through human rights bodies in an international forum as well as the national tribunals. In this regard, the contribution made by the Indian judiciary in the development of environmental jurisprudence and provide remedies to the victims of environmental degradation by applying the right-based approach to environmental protection is a clear example how the framework of human rights can contribute in the protection of environment and the very existence of the humanity. Talking about the interrelationship between human rights and environment, there are three approaches prevailing in this regard. The first approach is one where the environmental protection is described as a possible means of fulfilling human rights standards. Here, the end is fulfilling human rights and the route is through environmental law. The second approach states that the legal protection of human rights is an effective means to achieve the ends of conservation and environmental protection. So, this approach highlights the present existing human rights as a route to environmental protection. The focus here is on the existing human right. Okay? The third approach is where the human rights and the environment is to deny the existence of any formal connection between the two at all. So according to this approach, there is no requirement for an environmental human right. There can occasionally be a conflict between the established human rights and the protection of environment. Nevertheless, clearly there is a prima facie rhetorical and moral advantage in making the environment a human right issue. Whether the international human rights law can contribute to environmental protection is an issue that remains to be conclusively resolved. But scholars have discussed the relationship between human rights and environmental protection, between human rights and environment protection at length. The international environmental law and human rights law have intertwined objectives and strive for better conditions of life on Earth. Preservation, conservation and restoration of the environment is necessary and integral part of the enjoyment of right to health, right to food and right to life, including a decent quality of life. So thus, a close link clearly shows that a right to environment can easily be incorporated in the core of human rights protection, whose ultimate purpose is the blooming of rights or personalities of all human beings. The tight separation between the different branches of international law with regard to human rights and environmental law is not conducive to positive interactions between environmental and human rights law. Now, let us look into certain international instruments that establishes the linkage between the environment and human rights law. So, the linkage between environment and human rights may be traced in two ways. Either one looks at the existing international human rights law in order to examine whether it provides environment rights, or one can study international environmental law and looks for human rights norms within it. So there is no explicit right to environmental quality in the core international human rights instruments like the UDHR, ICCPR and ICESR. But if you look into the provisions of ICESR, that is the International Convention on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, it mentions that the issue of environment in relation to hygiene. Likewise, in the Convention on the Rights of Child, that is the CRC, the issue of environment discussed in terms of prevention of disease and malnutrition. The Stockholm Declaration also stated the human right to adequate conditions of life in an environment of a quality that permits a life of dignity and well-being. The Rio Declaration on Environment and Development 1992 includes the concept of sustainable development and the rights of future generations to a healthy environment. The Rio Declaration stated that human beings are at the center of concerns for sustainable development and they are entitled to a healthy and productive life in harmony with the nature. In the 20 years between the United Nations Conference on the Human Environment that happened in the year 1972 and the United Nations Conference on Environment and Development that happened in the year 1992, increasing attention has been paid to the impact of environmental problems on human rights. But the problem here is that the larger part of the international environmental law still belongs to the category of soft law. Apart from these international instruments that provides for the interrelationship between human rights and environment, some progress made in the form of resolution, special reports and debates by the human rights bodies and specialized agencies working in the area of environment and human rights in this regard. One of the most encouraging steps in this direction has been the work in the United Nations Subcommission on Prevention of Discrimination and Protection of Minorities. So, in the year 1994, a special committee formed under this commission proposed a set of draft principles providing for the standalone environmental right that is described as the right to a secure, healthy and ecologically sound environment. Further, in the year 2002 also, a joint expert seminar was convened by the United Nations Commission on Human Rights, inviting the High Commissioner for Human Rights and the Executive Director of United Nations Environment Programme, which concluded that the national and international developments reflect the growing interrelationship between approaches to guaranteeing human rights and environment protection. In that seminar, it was also observed that the role of environment protection is a precondition for the effective enjoyment of human rights. Further, in the year 2005, the United Nations Secretary General's report on relationship between human rights and the environment. So it was a very specific instrument on the topic that we are dealing with. That is the report on relationship between human rights and the environment. So in that report, it concluded that since the World Summit on Sustainable Development 2002, there has been growing recognition of the connection between environment protection and human rights. Apart from the international instruments, we can also see some regional human rights instruments that establishes the relationship between human rights and environment. The African Charter on Human Rights and People's Rights and the additional protocol to the American Convention on Human Rights in the area of economic, social, and cultural rights make a explicit reference to the environment. So if you look into Article 24 of the African Charter on Human Rights, it recognizes that all people have the right to a generally satisfactory environment favorable for their development. Similarly, under Article 11, it states that everyone shall have the right to live in a healthy environment and to have access to basic public services. It also states that the state parties shall promote the protection, preservation, and improvement of the environment. Further, the human rights treaty bodies and the regional human rights mechanisms have interpreted their respective human rights instruments in a manner that recognizes the environmental dimensions protected rights. So what we can construe from here is that the relationship between human rights and environment is well established in regional instruments than in the international instruments. It is very relevant to reiterate that though the regional human rights instruments recognize the right to a healthy environment and states the obligation to protect, to preserve and improve the environment, it does not allow the individual to file a petition in case the state is not fulfilling its obligations. Environmental harm can only be alleged by showing that it can cause severe human rights violations guaranteed under these instruments. In regard to the right to a healthy environment, the role of regional human rights institution and the domestic court is quite commendable. The right to a quality environment has been given content by regional human rights tribunals and national courts through the incorporation of environmental jurisprudence, laws, principles, and standards. So such bodies increasingly utilize the environmental standards to adjudicate human rights claims related to the environment and to judge whether or not states have complied with their legal obligations. Now, let us look into the Indian perspective of the interrelationship between environment and human rights. In India, a state of natural imbalance has been developed by many human-centric activities such as industrialization, urbanization, and large-scale exploitation of natural resources, leading to environment damage, and it has subsequently led to many serious repercussions on the on a large scale, including global warming, drought, flood, environmental refugees and migrations, health issues, ozone depletion, etc. At the same time, a lack of strong legislative measures also worsens the situation. It is quite pertinent to mention that the country, which was self-sufficient in terms of natural resources, now natural resources like water, air, forest, etc., has come to a stage of threat. India has witnessed various large superstructures, mega dams, and large industrial units, which have the potential to host millions of people in one stroke without taking into account their social, economic, and cultural aspects of life. A large number of people became the direct victim of these mega projects and were forced to migrate or lose the cultural identity, their land, employment, etc., and they have been forced to live in a degraded environment or an environment that is not friendly to them. The approach which is being followed by the government in India is exclusive in nature, means without taken into account the interest of those affected. Though not often, we can say many instances where it has actually happened. So this is the very reason that the present world has seen different kind of stiff resistance phenomena at regular intervals. The voice has become more vocal in the recent years because of the increasing awareness and the support of the local grassroots organizations. The Narmada Bachao Andolan, the Anti-Tehri Dam Movement, Silent Valley Project, Bhopal Gas Disaster Protest, etc. are some of the major movements to protect the environment and the human rights of the society concerned. So if the approaches of sustainable development, alternative viable development, and redefining of development are proceeded with, it will protect the environment without hampering the development. The Indian judiciary also played a remarkable role to put the issue of environmental degradation in the framework of fundamental rights to provide remedies to the victim of environmental degradation. In the year 1976, provisions were inserted into the Constitution of India that imposed responsibility on both the state and citizens to protect the environment. The Indian judiciary has also considered sustainable development as a basic mantra of striking a balance between environment and development through this universal agenda. The courts in general and the Supreme Court in particular tried its best to fulfill the aspirations related to the right to environment and to fill the gaps present in the environmental law. It also gave a liberal interpretation of the existing laws in the light of international human rights instruments to achieve the goal of human dignity by easy access to basic life support elements like water, air, and healthy surroundings through the route of human rights law. Various landmark judgments on the environmental protection were also delivered by the way of public interest litigation. The Constitution of India is one of the very few constitutions in the world that responds to the problem of environment. So it is by the 42nd Constitutional Amendment that happened in the year 1976 and the judicial interpretations down the year that the law of the Constitution developed the environmental jurisprudence in India. The broad meaning given to right to life guaranteed under Article 21 of the Indian Constitution in the case of Manekha Gandhi that happened in the year 1978 enable the court to accommodate various rights within the ambit of right to life. The case of Rural Litigation Entitlement Kendra is one of the earliest cases where the court dealt with the issues relating to the environment and ecological balance. Further, in the cases of Francis Corelli, the court set out a list of positive obligations on the state as a part of the duty correlative to the right to life. The link between environmental quality and the right to life was discussed by the Supreme Court in the Charanlal Sahu case. In Subhash Kumar case that happened in the year 1991, the court observed that the right to life guaranteed by Article 21 includes the right of enjoyment of pollution-free water and air for full enjoyment of life. A similar spirit has been expressed in the one of the recent cases that happened in the year 2004, N.D. Jayal versus Union of India. The Supreme Court has declared that the adherence to sustainable development in a sine qua non for maintenance of symbolic balance between the right to development and development. So this concept is an integral part of right to life under Article 21 of Constitution. There is a long list of cases in which the Supreme Court recognized the right to healthy environment as a part of human right jurisprudence and provides remedy to the victim of environmental harm. The role played by Mr. M.C. Mehta in establishing the relationship between human rights and environment is also worth mentioning. While analyzing the judicial decisions, it is evident that the judicial approach is the right-based approach that is applied by the Indian judiciary, which is the right step in the protection of environment. The judiciary in India has played a vital role in the development of environment jurisprudence, especially by interpreting the constitutional provisions and national laws in terms of international environmental law and international human rights law through the tool of public interest litigation and also by liberalizing the rule of locus standi. Where it is not that any person who has been affected by any act that violates his own rights only, but anybody can approach the court for enforcing the right of anybody. So that is how the rule of locus standi is liberated in India, especially when it comes to the matters relating to environment protection. So, to conclude, whatever perspective one adopts regarding the link between human rights and the environment, it is clear that failure to preserve a healthy environment has a clear and even increasing effect on the enjoyment of human rights. The linkage of human rights to the environment not only is helpful to protect the environment, but at the same time, the human rights system would be strengthened by incorporation of environmental concerns, which helps in enabling the expansion of the scope of human rights protection in the area of environment. As the issue of environmental protection does not recognize the political boundary and world's marginalized people are many times forced to pay the price of the selfishness of others. So bringing a human right approach to environment protection can stop this happening. Further, human rights protection will be strengthened with the incorporation of environmental protection because it extends human rights protection to an area that was previously overlooked. So that's all with this session. See you in some other session. Thank you.